Good morning, Columbia Grove. Just want to say thank you. Thank you for your continued support of the food bank. Thank you for your continued generosity in your offerings for the church. Last week, I talked about tithing your stimulus. If you're fortunate enough that that extra $1,200 isn't needed for your rent, your mortgage, your food, your insurance, whatever it is to take care of your family, I'd encourage you to take 10% of that and tithe it to the church. Also, right now, we're getting ready for our annual meeting. And yes, we will have one, May 17th, right after the worship service. Annual meeting, it'll be online. It'll be, we're presuming, Zoom. We're working on ways right now to do voting online and figure out things we never thought we'd have to do before, but we will get it done. Also, if there's we have a couple more positions open for different teams and committees here at the church. If you're interested in that and you're a member, please contact Linda Belton. Thank you. God bless. Love like Jesus.
My name's Nick Edmonds, and I am the Director of Student Ministries and Administration. Hey, we haven't been able to meet for youth group for quite some time, but we have found a way around that. On Thursdays at 6:30, we are doing Bible trivia and pop culture trivia. There will be prizes and all sorts of fun things. So if you have a 6th through 12th grader, we would love to have them. Please send your contact information to nedmonds@columbiagrove.org, and we will send you a link that your child can join in every single week and take part of that. We would love to make them part of the Impact Student Ministries family. Also, if you are an adult, right, we would love to contact with you and make you a more permanent part of our family as well. So please go to the I'm New page at columbiagrove.org and fill that out. That way we can keep in contact. We'll even make a $5 donation to the charity of your choice in your honor. Also, every time you check in, so if you're watching it on a Sunday, if you're watching us, go to check in, click it, say Columbia Grove. We will trigger a small donation to help fight COVID-19. Let's get rid of this thing. It's ridiculous. Connection groups right around the corner, and we would like you to be part of that as well. This helps you become a more stronger part of our family, and it helps us just have more people that we can love like Jesus with. So please go to the connection groups page, fill out all your contact information, and we will send you information on all the connection groups that we are offering and the best one that you can join. So we'd love to have you guys there.
Hi, my name is Gayla Tofton, and I am the Children's and Seniors Pastor here at Columbia Grove Covenant Church. I would ask that you remember our seniors in assisted living in your prayers, as they are not able to have family and friends visiting them, and they are beginning to feel quite lonely. Also, did you know we have a Facebook page just for kids and their parents? It is facebook.com/Columbia Grove Kids/. We want to support you and your family during this hard season in any way we can, so join us on Facebook for some fun activities and stories. Again, I can't wait to see you all face to face, and I am praying that you will have a blessed week.
Hey there, Columbia Grove, it's Nick Edmonds. Hey, did you know that the Bible has several different kinds of writings? We have prophetic, such as Revelations. We have historic, which is most of the Old Testament. We have some biographical stuff, such as Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And there's even some poems and some songs written in there. Different kinds of writings require different kinds of reading. They also require different kinds of interpretation. So how is it that we can better enrich our life if we don't understand how it is that we're supposed to read these things? Well, hopefully we can get one step closer. I am offering a connection group, and we're going to be reading through this Journey into God's Word. It's a nice, thin chapter book. This actually used to be a textbook that they taught in college, and they just condensed it into the simplest form, which is awesome because I'm a simple guy. I need simple instructions, right? This book is going to help us learn how to take the culture, the history, all of that, combine it into our reading of the Bible so that we can better understand what it is that we're reading. Okay, this group is going to be offered on Tuesday nights at 6:30 on Zoom. So you guys will be able to join in the comfort of your home, in your pajamas, however that may be, and join us. So how do you join? Here's how you're going to do it. You can either email me personally at nedmonds@columbiagrove.org, or you can go to columbiagrove.org, click connection groups, and fill out the information on there. Under the About Me section, just write, I'd like to join Nick's group, or I'd like to join the Better Understanding the Bible group. Okay, give us enough information. I will connect with you and get you guys a link. What you need to do in the meantime, till you hear back, is you need to go on Amazon. You need to buy this book, okay? This is Journey into God's Word. It is by J. Scott Duvall and J. Daniel Hayes. Okay, it's about $10 on Amazon. Order it now so that it is here. We are going to begin on the 5th, so you got plenty of time. Also, I do encourage you maybe read the first couple chapters so that when we meet up, you guys are ready to discuss. I can't wait to see how many people sign up. Let's become more biblically literate, and let's just absolutely let the Lord bless us through us better understanding His Word.
Good morning, everybody. Pastor Paul. Hey, one of the many hats I wear here is in charge of the volunteers, and if any of you happen to have a battery-operated weed eater or a gas one, we could use some weed eating around the church. You can see the sign behind me on Sunset Highway. It'd be nice to get some of those weeds taken down. Also on the driveway up the hill, we also have a weed eater donated that's a battery-operated one. So, if you have some time right now, you'd like to take 15 minutes, half hour, an hour, and help out the church, send me an email, paul@columbiagrove.org, or get a hold of me, and I'll be happy to get you to work. God bless.
fabulous, oh grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. I don't want to abuse your grace. God, I need it every day. It's the only thing that ever really makes me want to change. Your forgiveness is like sweet, sweet honey on my lips. Like the sound of a symphony in my ears. It's like holy water, your forgiveness.
That would make a difference. Let's try that again. Like I said, this is a totally live Sunday morning. Which means that mistakes happen, like I forgot to plug in my mic. But we are here in the Thompson house, which means that if you hear a dog barking, that means that somebody has been walking down Cherry Street and Piper is letting us know. Or if you see our cat marauding around, he's in fine form today, so we'll see what he decides to do. Karen and Julia, thank you so much for leading in that song. Just love remembering how Jesus changes people's lives. We are going to be celebrating communion a little bit later in the service today. So if you have some sort of a bread, some sort of juice around, maybe have that close by. And then whether you're on your own or whether you are worshiping today with other people, we can still celebrate communion together. I just want to echo some of the thanks that you heard from Paul in the announcements. Just thanks, church, for being generous. Thanks for giving. Thanks for giving online. You can see the link on how to do that in the notes around the service. And also just thank you for supporting the food bank. Like locally, the amount of food that's going out is about 8 to 10 times what's normal. And you've been enormously generous. I mean, this is the season where I think a lot of us are feeling that a little bit of frustration, a little bit of anxiety. You know, we're missing some of the things that we could have done. You know, so maybe you're missing apple blossom this weekend or things like that. But every time we choose to give up our time and give up our resources and give up our care to benefit others, it's part of loving like Jesus. So thank you for doing that. So yeah, we're going to just move into a time of prayer and praise as Eric and Heather lead us in a song, Scandal of Grace. And while that song's playing, I just invite you to share some sort of a praise phrase, and we can and as you see those phrases going up, you know, like one another's phrases, encourage one another that way, or as prayer requests go up. If you're praying for that prayer request, then you know, just like it, just to let people know that we're in this together. And then after that, Anita's going to lead us in a time of congregational prayer. So let me just open this up with a time of prayer, and then we'll go into that song together. Lord, thank you that we can gather, and that even online on Sunday morning, that we can. And we're all in different places, different living rooms, different places, not only around this valley, but as I'm seeing people signing in online, all around the state, in some cases, just all around the country. God, thank you that we can join together in worship. And so, Lord, we pray that you would be glorified through this gathering, and we pray that we would be listening deeply to the work of your Holy Spirit in our lives. Thank you that your word can encourage us and can strengthen us. So we just commit this morning to you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, let's worship.
Grace, what have you done? Murder for me on that cross, accused in absence of wrong, sin washed away in your blood, too much to make sense of it all. Know that your love breaks my fall. Scandal of grace died in my place, so my soul will live. Oh, to be like you, to give all I have just to know you. Jesus, there's no one beside you. Forever the hope in my heart. Your sting, your power's as dead as my sin. The cross has taught me to live. In mercy, my heart now to sing. The days and its troubles shall come. I know that your strength is enough. A scandal of grace, you died in my place, my soul will live. Oh, to be like you, to give all I have just to know you. Jesus, there's no one beside you. Forever the hope in my heart. Because of your love and my soul. give all I have just to know you. Jesus, there's no one beside you. Forever the hope in my heart.
There we go. So now Anita's going to lead us in the time of congregational prayer.
Good morning. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, we just thank you for this beautiful day, for the sunshine, for spring, for your hand in creation that we can see at work. God, I just pray for each family listening this morning. God, you know what our needs are, where we're at, and just pray that you would meet us there. God, thank you that we can worship together and grow together and encourage one another. God, we just pray for families, for the Halverson family, that you would be with them as they mourn the passing of Pauline. Just give them comfort in this time when they can't be together as they would like to be. Just give them the peace and the comfort they need. God, for Bob and Janet Tridle as they mourn the passing of their grandson, Joshua, be with them. Give them peace and comfort as they mourn. God, we pray for Jeremy Melandra as he recovers from heart surgery. God, that you would be present with the doctors and nurses as they care for him, that you would just touch his body as he recovers and give him the strength he needs. God, we pray for Jim Grove as he continues to recover from COVID-19. Be with those who are caring for him and his family. Give him strength. For the Gandhi family, as they prepare to serve you and minister in Shaktulik, be with them today. We just thank you for them and the calling you've put on their life and the gifts that you've given them. Just prepare them for what you're calling them to. God, we pray for those facing financial uncertainty, addiction, illness, relationship challenges. You know exactly what those are. And you can meet people where they are. Just provide what they need today. God, we pray for our national, state, and local leaders who are having to make so many decisions that affect the welfare of our nation and our world. Just be with them today. Give them wisdom and direction. And as they make those difficult decisions, God, that you would be in it. God, we pray for the leaders in our congregation, for the staff, for the leadership team, connection group leaders, and those who serve. God, thank you for them. And just pray that as a congregation, we continue to seek you and what you're calling us to, and to serve the people around us, and to reach out and love people like you do. God, I just pray that we would see how we can serve you, be a hope to our community, to our families, just that we would see you leading us. God, just be with us today and through this week. And just thank you we can go forward knowing that you are with us and you'll provide just what we need. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thanks, honey. And now we want to turn our attention to God's Word. We're in a series in the Apostles' Creed. And I don't know about you, I've actually been kind of enjoying at least being able to preach in this format, because if you know me at all, you know that I'm a teacher and I'm a nerd. So being able to combine, my daughters are just nodding their heads on the other side of the camera. Thanks for the affirmation, honey. Now, all right. My hope in this time of uncertainty is that we would anchor our hearts in something that is certain and something that transcends our immediate experience. And so that's why I'm grateful that we can go deeper into the Apostles' Creed and go into the scripture passages that surround it. So let's hear God's word together.
Convinced by the evidence of the resurrection and empowered by the Holy Spirit, the early church grew, even at times in the midst of intense persecution. But as the church grew, there came with it a need for increasing clarity. What are the most important, most foundational, most essential aspects of faith? What's the difference between honest Christian diversity, where Jesus-loving, Bible-believing Christians just come to different conclusions on things, and heresy, those ideas that are unbiblical, are wrong, are false, and are dangerous to the faith and must be rejected? Well, that's where the creed comes in. The words that we now know as the Apostles' Creed, they've been part of Christian worship since as early as the 2nd century, some 1900 years. Now, if you grew up in a church tradition that spoke the Apostles' Creed on a weekly or an occasional basis, let me know in the comments and we can encourage each other with that. But the Apostles' Creed in worship and in discipleship, in addition to clarity, it also helps us with balance. It helps us to pay attention to those aspects of faith that we might otherwise overlook. Maybe they don't come to us as naturally, or maybe they're just hard to talk about. Actually, today we're going to look at one of those aspects, something that in the modern church we don't talk about very often because it's hard to talk about it. It also provides us with community. Not only in the contents of the creed, as we affirm words like the communion of saints and recognizing that we're part of a larger body, but just the act of saying the creed together unites us with other Christians across time and space. Words that have anchored the church through all sorts of hardship, through famine, persecution, pandemic, recession, war. These are words that our brothers and sisters in faith, they've spoken before us. And these are part of the deep, deep roots of the church. That's also why I think it's so important that here in this season, in this time of pandemic, in this time of uncertainty, that we spend some time with the Apostles' Creed. I'm reminded that in a storm, the trees that survive are the trees that have deep roots. Well, the Apostles' Creed, that's part of the deep roots of Christian faith. And that's why I would urge us to spend some time there. Now, I know you've got a lot of other things going on in your life, from economic uncertainty, maybe medical uncertainty, job insecurity. Some of you are dealing with homeschooling right now. Or maybe you're just missing apple blossom and wishing you could be doing other things this weekend. But because it's a time of uncertainty, it's all the more important that we dig deep into those things that are timeless, and not just a response to our immediate situation. So what I would urge you, for the next 20 minutes or so, stop the scroll as much as you can. Turn off the distractions. I know some of you got kids crawling on you right now, but as much as you can, turn off the distractions. And let's focus in and on these words of the Apostles' Creed, and more importantly, on the scriptural truths that they help to illuminate and remind us of. So with that as an introduction, let's hear the words of the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary,
suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried.
He descended to the dead.
On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven.
He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead.
I believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Holy Catholic Church,
the communion of saints,
the forgiveness of sins,
the resurrection of the body,
and the life everlasting.
Amen.
We began our series in the Apostles' Creed 2 weeks ago by taking a closer look at the opening sentence in the Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. And we discovered that every word in that sentence is just jam-packed with meaning. Then last week we looked at the first part of the section in the Creed that talks about who Jesus is, and again found that every word, every phrase was just jam-packed with meaning. Well, today, as we pick up the second part of that section on Jesus, we need to take a look at the line in the Creed that is by far the most controversial. Now, right after the line, crucified, died, and was buried, we see this line. He descended to the dead. Or you might have heard it this way. He descended into hell. This is the only line in the creed that doesn't have multiple clear verses surrounding and supporting it. Now, the closest thing we have to a verse that opens us up to that possibility is found in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 19 and 20. Let's take a little look at that. After being made alive, he, meaning Jesus, went and made proclamation to the imprisoned spirits, to those who were disobedient long ago when God waited patiently in the days of Noah while the ark was being built. Yeah, it's not exactly clear. And in 1 Peter chapter 3, this is part of a larger conversation on how God gives strength to endure times of suffering. It seems really unlikely that Peter would drop this other huge theological idea into a passage like this. Furthermore, we have the problem that the place that we would know as hell, the place where people are separated from the active presence of God, the lake of fire that is described in Revelation chapter 20, is a place that only exists in its fullness after Jesus has returned and after Jesus has judged the whole world. In other words, at this point in history, at the point between the crucifixion and the resurrection, it doesn't exist yet. So, yeah, this one's a little bit of a head-scratcher. This is a part where I wonder if this part of the creed isn't just an example of human imagination kind of sneaking into our faith. We do that too. Imagination that came out of the honest question of what was Jesus doing between Friday afternoon when he died and Sunday morning when he rose again? Was he just dead or was he doing something while he was dead? As if dying for human sin and conquering death in his resurrection wasn't enough. Well, point is, the scriptures are absolutely clear that Jesus died and that he really died. The scriptures are absolutely clear that Jesus rose again and that in his conquering death that he offers us resurrection life too. The Bible is really clear on that. But to say more than that is probably to move away from clear scriptural teaching. So this is the one line in the creed that you might want to skip, especially the version of the creed that involves the word hell. So let's move on to the next line in the creed, and let's move back into some really clear scriptural teaching and look at how that impacts our life. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. We read about Jesus' resurrection and his ascension in Acts chapter 3, verses 3 through 11. Let's take a closer look. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." So after 40 days of clear evidence of the resurrection, Jesus ascended back into heaven. Now, here's why he did that, and here's what that means for us. See, Jesus was returning to the place of unlimited presence and unlimited power after spending roughly 33 years as a self-limited human being who would die to redeem all humanity. And by returning to heaven and sending the Holy Spirit, it meant that Jesus' presence and his power were no longer limited just to the geographic location where Jesus, the human being, happened to be. You see, now through the Holy Spirit, Jesus is everywhere, and his power is unlimited. We read about that in Philippians chapter 2, verses 9 through 11. Let's take a closer look at that. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue acknowledge that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Or we see a similar idea in Romans chapter 8, verse 34. Who then is the one who condemns? No one. Jesus Christ, who died more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. So Jesus, who is the second member of the Trinity, who is present and participating in creation with God the Father, and who redeemed all humanity by becoming human and giving his life for all humanity, currently, right now, he rules with the Godhead over all of the universe. And so you and I, we have an advocate in heaven who is rooting for us, who understands us, who understands our stresses and our fears and our anxieties. He understands what it means to be human. Jesus is more powerful than you could ever know. And Jesus is closer than you think. He understands what you're going through right now, this morning. Jesus gets it. And Jesus rules in heaven. Jesus rules. Jesus understands. And Jesus, right now, is advocating for you, for me, and for us. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and he is seated at the right hand of the Father. And he will come to judge the living and the dead. Acts chapter 17, verse 31 puts it like this. For he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead. Revelation chapter 20 fast forwards us through history to the point in time after Jesus has returned, after all evil has been conquered, after Satan and all his minions have been eliminated from the earth. And we pick things up in verse 11. Then I saw a great white throne and him who was seated on it. The earth and the heavens fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And they saw the dead, great and small, standing before the throne. And books were opened. Another book which was opened, which is the book of life. The dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. The sea gave up the dead that were in it. And death and Hades gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what they had done. Then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death. Anyone whose name was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. This is a part of our faith that, sadly, in the church today, we don't often talk about because it's hard to talk about. But it's a part of our faith that we must remember. It's one of the reasons why we need the scriptures and why the creed can help us find balance in our understanding of the scriptures. We must not neglect this. See, we have been redeemed by Jesus, who died for our sins, who rose again to new life, who offers us the free gift of the forgiveness of God. And this same Jesus will one day judge us. We, you and I, all of us, every person that ever lived, will stand before him and we will answer for what we have done with the gift that has been offered to us. Think about it. The most kind, loving, self-sacrificial person that ever lived. The same one who is right now advocating for you in heaven. This same one who gave his life, who is advocating for you, who rose again so that you and I, if we receive that gift, can experience that new life in Christ right now through the Holy Spirit of abundant life, of eternal life on the other side of death. This same one, this is the one, this is the only one who is fully qualified to judge our lives. And he will. And if we reject his gracious, freely given offer of rescue, if we reject it, he will allow us to face the consequences of our own choice. And so I've got to give us some time today to think about and to personally respond to that gift. If there's one thing that this season of history, this time of pandemic, this time of uncertainty has taught us, it's that the things that we thought were solid, the things in our culture that, you know, whether it's stock market or money or fame or status or, you know, like, those things are not as certain as we thought. They're not certain at all. The only things that we can really count on are the things of God. The things that are eternal, that transcend time and space, the things that transcend our immediate experiences right now. And so if you've never given your heart to Christ, or you feel like you have wandered away from him in some way, and you've put him on the back burner, it's time to come home. And I want to give you a chance to do that. Whether that's just in the privacy of your own thoughts right now, or maybe, and in just a moment, like, I mean, real time, Pastor Andrew, I'm going to post a line that says, I'm choosing Jesus. And if you are taking a new step of faith, whether that's a renewal of commitment or whether that's, you're just wanting to cross the line of faith for the first time, I'd like you to like that post. And I promise that I or one of the other pastors here at the church will follow up with you this week. Because we want to be there for you and with you. We want to support you. We think that following Jesus is the most important and sometimes the scariest decision that we can make with our lives. But it's a decision that we cannot put off. Please, please, please choose Jesus. Don't put it off. Because you and I, we, all of us, one day, and it may be sooner than we think, one day, we are going to stand before him as he judges the world and he judges our own lives. So I'd like to lead us in a time of prayer. I'd like you to invite you to join me this next Thursday night, 6:30 on Zoom. We'll go deeper into all these things, talk through the details. I'm sure there are lots of questions. There's so many things that I can't cover here, or that, you know, I'm just a flawed human being and I said it wrong. So I hope you could join me there. After I lead us in the time of prayer, I want to invite us to say the creed together and invite you to say it in a way that is remembering what you're saying and to allow it to anchor your heart. Because I believe that these words, words that have been spoken by so many others who have gone before us, that these are words that can anchor our faith, that can give us the strength that we need to endure today, and can give us the perspective we need to make good decisions, not only about tomorrow and next week and the week to come, but the kinds of decisions that make a difference for eternity. Jesus, who is in heaven right now, advocating for you, he gave his life for you so that you and I could live in full communion and relationship with God. And he wants your life now, your life with him now. He wants your life to count. So whatever it means for you this morning to take that step of faith, to entrust your fears to him, to make him your Lord and declare him as your Savior and to remember that one day you and I will stand before him. Whatever that means for you today, please, please, please take that step. Let's pray together. Jesus, thank you that you died for our sin, that you rose again, conquering death, that in your resurrection you offer us new life. Thank you that you ascended into heaven and that through the Holy Spirit you are present everywhere and your power is available to us all the time. Oh God, we need your power today. We need your peace. We need your healing. We need your perspective. And we remember that one day each of us is going to stand before you. Thank you that when you look on us, you look on one that you have died for, that you rose again for, that you are advocating for even now. And Lord, I pray for those who might feel distant from you today, God, I pray that they would respond to you, that they'd open their hearts and they'd experience the peace and presence that comes only from you. And Lord, I pray that you would strengthen us to faithfully follow and to faithfully trust you, no matter what life throws at us today. God, anchor us, root us deep in a faith that lasts. And so we pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I would invite us to join together in the words of the Apostles' Creed, words that declare our faith, but words that are also very much a prayer. I mean, this is a declaration to our own souls, our own hearts, and an encouragement to each other. And it's a way of standing with the brothers and sisters who have gone before us over the last 1900 years in faith. So we're going to put the words on the screen, and I invite you to say them out loud. There's a line that you can optionally skip in there that we've already talked about. Or if there's other parts of the creed that you're not sure what you're saying yet, feel free to skip that. But I would urge you to come back, you know, next week and the weeks following as we spend more time with each of those phrases, so that when you say a creed like this, you know what you're saying. But as an act of faith, let's declare these words together. Lauren, would you mind putting them on the screen? Thanks, honey. It's just awesome having her. She's amazing. All right, let's say these words together.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And so now we're going to move into a time of communion, where we are, in some ways, we're celebrating the communion of saints. This is an act where, as we remember Jesus, we are joined across time and space with all others who are remembering Jesus, all other followers of Jesus in all time. It is a way for us with bread and juice to remember Jesus' death on our behalf, to remember the forgiveness of sins. So invite you to get some bread of some sort, some juice. This is actually grape juice from grapes in our garden from last year. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, and giving thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples to eat, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body. It's given for you." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it, remembering me. For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." Let's pray. Lord, thank you that through the bread, through the cup, we remember you. We remember your sacrifice. We remember what you did on our behalf. We remember the forgiveness of sins. We participate in the communion of saints, and we look forward to your soon return. We look forward to the resurrection of the body. We look forward to the life everlasting. And Lord, we pray that as we join together, as a family, as a family of faith across the internet, as we join together with brothers and sisters of every nation and race and language right now in this sacred meal, Lord, we pray that you would be glorified. We pray that you would strengthen your church. This is a hard time, but this is a time where the light can shine brightly. As you make a difference in our hearts, you free us from those places of self-interest. You free us from those places of despair and discouragement. You turn us first and foremost towards you and then towards one another. And so, Lord, we pray that this time, however it's being shared with whatever elements it has and in whoever is able to join it in this moment, we pray, God, that you would work profoundly through it. We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. And so I'd invite you and one of our daughters, Lauren Elizabeth, you want to join us? Yeah, there we go. They're on the other side of the camera and making everything go. But I invite you to serve communion to one another with these words: "This is Christ's body given for you, and this is Christ's blood shed for you." And so, Anita, this is Christ's body given for you, and this is Christ's blood shed for you.
Andrew, this is Christ's body broken for you, Christ's blood shed for you.
Thank you.
Elizabeth, this is Christ's body broken for you, Christ's blood shed for you. Lauren, this is Christ's body broken for you, and Christ's blood shed for you.
And let's join together in the words of the Lord's Prayer. And Lauren, would you mind putting those on the screen? Our Father, which art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive them that sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Well, everybody, thanks for joining us this morning for worship. I want to invite you to join us for like an online coffee hour that will be starting in just a few minutes. If you check your email this morning, if you're a part of the, like if you ever receive email from Columbia Grove, there's a link there. Just click on the link. It'll take you right there and it'll give us a chance to just say hi face to face. And of course, I'd love to have you join me on Zoom Thursday night at 6:30 to go deeper into the Apostles' Creed, to ask questions, to challenge, to all those things. I mean, let's just help each other grow together. Now, one of the other little traditions we've had here is to actually close with a song. The doxology. my words are getting lost here. But honey, would you mind passing me a guitar? There we go. See, because everybody just keeps a guitar on the side of their couch, just barely off camera. But
praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
God bless you. See you soon. Keep loving like Jesus. Go in peace and serve the Lord.